touch more intimate.
Yes. Praise the Lord. Good morning, friends. How's everybody doing? Welcome to Faith and Healing class. I'm Eddie Storino. I'm one of the pastors here at Abundant Grace Church, where we're streaming live. I encourage you, grab your Bible, get something to take some notes, come on into the classroom, and let's prepare our hearts to hear from God. Amen. Let's just release faith together that we'll hear what we're supposed to hear. This is the place where our spirit gets fed, our faith grows stronger, and we learn how to overcome. Amen? So let's just release faith together concerning that, that we'll hear from the Spirit of God and that He'd be glorified. Amen? Heavenly Father, we thank You for the opportunity to study Your Word. Your Word is truth. Your Word is life, Father. And those who embrace it, and live their life by it, Father, excel. They're supplied. They're sustained. Father, Your word is life and health and medicine to us. And we just ask the Holy Ghost, the great teacher, to teach us this morning. As I yield to You, Father, speak through me words that You know we need to hear. Father, I thank You for revelation knowledge. I thank You for answers to questions that we may have, for impartations, Father, for truth and light to shine in our hearts. And as it does, Father, may we grow and become and do all that You've asked of us so that Your blessings can flow through us and we establish Your covenant in this earth today. May You be glorified in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, God is good. It's good to be with you again. We've been studying along the lines, talking obviously about faith and healing, but we were looking at the law, the spirit of life in Christ Jesus has redeemed us, made us free from the law of sin and death. And so glory to God, that's good news for a believer. Amen. There are laws that are put in place, and as being in this world, but not of it, because we're in Christ now, there were laws. There was a sentence imposed upon us, a death sentence, because of sin. You know, because of one man's sin, death reigned. But the grace of God and His goodness, and because of what Jesus did on the cross, redeemed us. So the Spirit, the law, the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set us free, has redeemed us and delivered us from the law of sin and death, which is the curse on this earth. And so many people are bound by that. And it's sad that they don't know the truth, or that they reject the truth, because Satan is the god of this world and he's blinded their minds from hearing and receiving truth. But glory to God, we are, we're of those who believe. Amen. I'm in that group. And I'm on the winning team, and it's my job and your job to go out and share the good news with everybody that we can, everybody who'd be willing to hear. And if you come across someone who scoffs and isn't willing to hear, well, then just move on to the next person who will be willing to hear, because someone wants to hear the truth. Amen? Glory to God. Before we go any further, let's just do our declarations and our prayers that Paul prayed in Ephesians and in Colossians. How many have been experiencing revelation knowledge being imparted to you since you've been praying these? You know, we need to do it expecting. We need to do it in faith. We need to ask in faith, fully expecting and cooperating with the Holy Spirit. Amen. We've been talking at great length about the Holy Spirit, our partner, our senior partner, our coach, our advocate. He knows the path that's before us, and He wants to guide us. But we need to take time to communicate with Him and then listen and yield to what He tells us. And these prayers will help us to do that. That's why we're doing this. And we're believing that we are seeing fruit from this, from these prayers. God's word never returns void, right? Always accomplishes what it's sent forth to do. We believe it's working. It's working. Amen. So Ephesians chapter 1, starting in verse 17, we're gonna pray these together right now. And it is a prayer. It's a prayer that we're going before the Lord about. And, you know, we've prayed it. And so we're not praying it over and over again as if He didn't hear us. I wanted to bring that out to you as well. We're not praying these as though he didn't hear us. We're reminding him of what we have prayed by making these confessions and declarations, and we're calling things that be not as though they are. And we're thanking him that he's working, that the Spirit of God is working on our behalf concerning these things that we declare. Faith calls things that be not as though they are. So we're not praying. It's important to understand that. We're not praying. We're speaking and declaring things in faith. We're not praying over and over again as if he didn't hear us. This is more of our declaration. Amen. In a way of thanksgiving, thanking him for hearing us. So Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17. It says, I pray to you, the glorious Father, the God of my Lord Jesus Christ, that you would give me. Now, as I've been doing these, I've been saying, I thank you that you were giving me a spirit of wisdom and revelation as I come to know you better. Then I will have deeper insight. I will know the confidence that you want me to have and the glorious wealth that your people will inherit. I kind of got hung up on that this morning. Glorious wealth. Glorious wealth. That means substance. That means substance. Here, in heaven, we got it. We're not in heaven. It's there waiting for us. But while we're here, we will have deeper insight. We will know the confidence that he wants us to have and the glorious wealth that your people will inherit. That's us. That's anyone who will believe. I will also know the unlimited greatness of your power as it works with might and strength for me, a believer. You worked with that same power in Christ when you brought him back to life and gave him the honored position, the one next to you, the Father, on the heavenly throne. And Jesus is far above all rulers, authorities, powers, lords, and all other names that can be named, not only in this present world, but also in the world to come. You have put everything under the control of him. You made him the head of everything for the good of the church. And the church is his body and completes him as he fills everything in every way. Ephesians 3, just turn over a chapter. Ephesians chapter 3 in verse 16. And again, this starts off, I'm asking you, God. I'm thanking you, Father, that you've heard me and that you were giving me a gift from the wealth of your glory. I pray and thank you that you would give me your inner strength and power through your Spirit. In him we live, we move, we have our being. That Christ will live in me through faith. I also pray that love may be the ground into which I sink my roots and on which I have my foundation. Love never fails, friends, ever. It may seem like you're taking the back seat or going the wrong way or things are coming against you. Know this, love never, ever fails. If you never want to fail, never get out of love. Always walk in love and you will always see victory. Always, things will turn around. This way, with all of God's people, I will be able to understand how wide, long, high, and deep that your love is. I will know Christ's love, which goes far beyond any knowledge. I am praying this so that I may be completely filled with you, Father God. Glory belongs to you, whose power is at work in me. By your power, you can do infinitely more than I can ask or imagine. Glory belongs to you in the church and in Christ Jesus for all time and eternity. Amen. Amen. Glory be to God. And lastly, Colossians chapter 1. Flip past Philippians and just go over to Colossians. Colossians chapter 1 and starting in verse 9. For this reason, I have not stopped praying and thanking you about this. I'm asking you, God, to fill me with the knowledge of your will through every kind of spiritual wisdom and insight. Do you believe that you're being filled with the knowledge of his will? I believe that because we speak it in faith. The Holy Ghost, our teacher, quickens us. He illuminates us. we get truth, wisdom, and insight. I ask this so that I will live the kind of life that proves I belong to you, Lord. It's the only way. His wisdom and knowledge and insight is the way we can live the life that people know that I belong to you. When I read this morning, I thought of this. I ask this so that I will live the kind of life that proves that I'm related to you. I like to say that. Proves that I'm related to you, that I'm your family. You know, people associate family. You know, that's why, you know, growing up, and we should get back to this, and I instill this in my own kids, but my parents always told me, and I know their parents always told them, don't ever bring disgrace to our family. So things that we do are a reflection on your family. Do you understand that? It's so important. Maybe you have a rascal in your family that has brought reproach to your name. And when people know about him, there's always that, that one. But it's a reproach. It brings a picture to your family name. How we live, friends, is important because it'll prove that we belong to him, that we're related to him. And I don't know about you, but my father deserves nothing but glory and honor and worship. And so my life needs to be one that points people to worship him, to want to worship him. Not when they look at me say, I don't want nothing to do with that. That family's messed up. You know what I'm saying? So that's why we're asking him to fill us with the knowledge of his will through every kind of spiritual wisdom and insight. And we're asking this so that we will live the kind of life that proves I belong to you, that proves that I am part of your family, that we are relatives, that we are related. I ask this. So then I will want to please you in every way as I grow in producing every kind of good work by this knowledge about you. I ask you to strengthen me by your glorious might with all the power that I need to patiently endure and overcome everything with joy. I also thank you, Father, for you have made me able to share the light, which is what you want me to inherit. You, Father God, have rescued me from the power of darkness, and you brought me into the kingdom of your Son, whom you love. Put us right in right standing with Jesus and the Father. Hallelujah. So, we need to continue to thank the Lord that we are being filled with the knowledge of his will. And we need to continue to yield to the Holy Ghost who lives on the inside of us. Look to him. He's our strengthener. He's our guide. He's our comforter. He's our coach. He's our advisor. He's our senior partner. We should yield to him. He has all the answers. Amen. So open up to your Bible, to Romans. You have your Bible open. Look at Romans chapter 8. We're going to look at this, and then I believe that we're going to go over to 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 6. I know last time we were together, I had mentioned that we were going to go there, and I don't think we ever made it there. But that's okay, because if we don't today, we may tomorrow. Praise God. Well, we're believing that we're hearing what the Spirit of God knows that we need anyway. So so let's just release faith with that. Stay in faith, actually. Romans chapter 8 in verse 1. We've been redeemed. This has everything to do with how we see ourselves in Christ. What we're about to read has everything to do with us walking in divine health and healing. It has everything to do with us believing and seeing ourselves well supplied and sustained. Everything. Everything. When you realize that you are no longer under the law of sin and death, but that you've been set free and acquitted from that judgment, it makes you happy. It makes you look at life a lot different. Glory to God. It actually makes you look at this life as so temporary. You know, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. You know, and you can see that a lot of people make a lot of excuses as to why they can't do things. But when you begin to look at where their treasure is, that's where their heart is. And, you know, it's nice to have great things in this life. But, you know, when you could care less if you have them and you're content and you're happy because you have the life of God in you, that's when the Lord pours his blessings on you. And when you're content that way, simply because Matthew 6:33, a person that is content is seeking first the interests and the kingdom of the Father. When that's your primary interest, you're interested in what he's serving his interests, then he makes sure you're consumed with that. He makes sure that you are well supplied, that your cup is overflowing. My cup overflows. Say that. My cup overflows. My cup is overflowing. My cup is so full and flowing out that it's just blessing other people. Glory to God. Because I care about what he cares about. I do. I'm interested in his work. Because this time that we have here on earth, it's an assignment. It's not our life to live how we want. We're here on assignment. We're here on a mission specific to do something. And it's to take care of God's service and his business. And then when we leave here, what we're doing here has everything to determine how what we got in heaven. Yes, we're going to have eternal life. But we know that those... You know, that knew what he was capable, knew that he was a 10 talent kind of a guy, and he did great things with that for his master. And because he did, the master said, "Well done, good and faithful servant. I've given you this. I will make you ruler over many things." And the same thing with the person with 5 talents. It wasn't the amount of talents that mattered. It was what you did. Did you serve the master's interests? Did you serve the master's 5 investments? And if you're a 5-person individual right now, that's okay. Be faithful with them. Be faithful with them. Because the person who got 1 was not faithful with his. His heart was in other things. And he used the excuse, "Well, I just know you're a hard guy, and you know you're pretty tough, and you gain interest in places that you don't. And so, just to be safe, I just figured, you know what? Let me just bury this, keep it safe. Let me just keep it in a bank, bury no interest, and then when you come back, I'll give it to you." Well, that irritated him. That irritated him. And we know what happened. We know what happened. But the person with 5 got the same response as the person with 10. It's the faithfulness behind what we're doing. Now, why am I saying that? Because the Spirit of God wants us to hear it. The Spirit of God wants us to hear that today, that we need to be God conscious. We need to be kingdom business minded. What is God interested in? And this has everything to do with walking in divine health. Because I believe that that people walk. I mean, yes, we have an enemy that wants to destroy us, kill, steal, and destroy us. But if we're consumed and obeying what the master has asked us to do, we have immunity from the enemy. That means that sickness can't ravage through your body. You know, sickness and disease is a result of sin and disobedience. It gives the enemy, in other words, it gives the enemy a right to inflict you with those things. But if we'll seal up every crack and give him no place by obeying the master, by serving his interests, then prosperity, divine health will follow you wherever you go. You'll walk in it. You'll walk in it. Just take inventory in your own life. You know, I know times in my own life when everything was miserable, when I didn't have enough, when I didn't feel well, when this hurt and that hurt. I wasn't serving the master's interests. We get sidetracked. We get derailed. We start looking at what we need, what we want, you know, the pursuit of happiness. God wants us happy, but happiness is attached to obedience. Prosperity is attached to obedience. Health and healing, provision is attached to obedience. It's not our life to live. We're here bought. We are the blood-bought church, the redeemed, here on assignment. To serve God's interests. And he's so good to us. He's given us eternal life. Now we have eternal life. If you're in Christ, you'll never die. You may stop living here, but you live eternally. You slip from here, never tasting death, right into the presence of God. But not only did he do that for us, he said, if you'll seek me first in my interest, all of these things, all of the good things that life has to offer us are ours for the taking. They are. The willing and the obedient get the best of the land, get the best things in life, drive the best cars, live in the best houses, wear the best clothes, eat the best food. The willing and obedient. But people want to skip the willing and obedient part, and they want to serve their interests and ask God to bless them. Well, God's not going to bless what you're serving. If you'll serve him, he'll bless you. He'll bless you. And furthermore, when we're not serving him, that's disobedience. And we know what disobedience does. Disobedience opens up the door, opens up the window, and gives the adversary who wants to kill us, steal us, and destroy us, gives him access into our life. Now, when he gains access, what is that allowing him to do? What is it enabling him to do? He may not come in and clean you out all at one sweep, but over time, little by little, he'll start picking at you. He'll start taking things. Things that you didn't notice were missing. But then one day when you go to look for it, you're like, oh man, where'd that go? Well, the thief took it from you because you let him in your house. Don't shout me down because I'm preaching good now. This is truth. This will make us free. This will make us free, friends. We're talking about walking in the provision and the fullness and the grace of God. See, the grace is there for the taking, but we need to obey what he's asking us to do. He wants us to live a surrendered life to him so that he is able to rebuke the devourer for our sake, so that he's able to bless us, to cause our cup to run over. Glory to God. So Romans chapter 8, and I'm really, really endeavoring to get over to 1 Peter, but I promise you anything. So Romans chapter 8 in verse 1, it says, there is therefore now no condemnation, no judgment, no death sentence against you if you're in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life, the law came in, the law of life, the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free, has acquitted you from the law of sin and death that was imposed on you. The verdict came down and you were declared innocent. Glory to God. Glory to God. The law of the Spirit of life. When I see things begin to get out of control in my own life, or the sea gets a little rough, or the road gets a little rocky and bumpy, I don't blame. I don't look out. I look in. And I evaluate real quick, and it don't take me long to do. And I take a look at my own life. Where's my affection? What am I doing? Am I obeying? Is there something that I'm not obeying? Am I yielding to the flesh? And the reason I do that is because the law of the Spirit of life has set me free. The only way I can be in bondage to the law of sin and death is if I put myself back there. So we can't look at other things. If things are spiraling out of control in your life, don't look out. You're the only one that could put yourself back in the prison. Do you understand that? Nobody else can. The devil can't even put you back there. But when we begin to look elsewhere and begin to walk away from the law of liberty, we put ourselves back under the law of sin and death. So we need to keep this flesh crucified every day. Every day, crucify the flesh. Because if we're serving Christ and we're walking in fullness, obediently, following hard after him, it's impossible, and I say this in my own life, it's impossible for me to be poor and it's impossible for me to be sick. It's impossible because I've been acquitted from that. Now, why in the world would I choose to go back and under judgment, put myself under judgment again, indict myself, and invite lack and sickness back into my life. When you look at it that way, you say, no, we would never, I wouldn't do that. Well, we do. We do it. We do it. The devil cannot just come and put something on you unless you give him access. And we give him access by not walking in obedience, by not following hard after him, by not seeking first the kingdom of God, by not walking in love, by not walking in love. Glory to God. So there's therefore now no sentence, no judgment for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin of death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. For those, verse 5, for those who live according to the flesh. Now here's the rest of this. For those who live according to the flesh, they set their mind, their affection on things of the flesh, the things of this natural world, the pursuit of happiness. If we're pursuing happiness for ourselves more than we're pursuing the things of God, we're setting ourselves up for failure. God wants you happy more than you want to be happy, but he has a way of making you that way, and it has to be followed. Those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. That's why I said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So when people say, I don't have time to go to church, I don't have time to get involved, I can't commit. Well, your treasure is elsewhere. Your treasure is elsewhere. And you know what? That's not condemning. That should convict you. God loves us, will forgive us. But our treasure needs to be in serving his interests. We should never say, oh, I don't have time to do something at the church because I'd rather go fishing or golfing. Listen, there's nothing wrong with fishing or golfing. I can't believe I'm going down here, but I am, because it's important. If you want to walk in divine health, if you want to increase in faith and you want to be prosperous, I need to submit my heart to Christ, to give him my life. My life is not for me to live the way I want. I'm here on assignment. I've been redeemed. Unless you want to live under the law of sin and death, then do it however you want. Do it however you want. But don't you dare ask God to bless you when you've put yourself back in prison. Do you see where I'm coming from this morning? Those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. The things of the Spirit. What are the things of the Spirit? Seeing people healed. Seeing people set free. Giving to those that are in need. Clothing those that need clothes. Feeding those that need food. Laying hands on the sick. Being a help to the church. Those are the things of the Spirit. Verse 6, for to set your mind on the flesh is death. But to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. I'm convinced of this, that if we will set our affection on things above, we would not need healing lines. We would be walking in the fullness of, is God not able? God is able. He made provision. He said that there's no condemnation for you. That sentence has been removed because the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus set you free, acquitted you from the law of sin and death. So that means all his grace is for me. It's for me. I can walk in it. If I'm not walking in it, it's not God's fault. It's not your wife's fault, your husband's fault, your kids, your employer, or your church. It's our fault. We have put ourselves back under the law of sin and death, and we've judgment again upon ourselves because of disobedience. Because of disobedience. Life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. Verse 9 of Romans 8. If, in fact, the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. And then there it is, Romans 8:11. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, and if you're born again, that Spirit dwells in you, then he who raised Christ from the dead will also, in addition to, give life to your mortal body through his Spirit who dwells in you. The Spirit gives life. The flesh tends to death, evil, and destruction. The Spirit gives life. His Spirit living in us causes life to our mortal body. That's why I've been saying, and we've been studying these things, healing starts in your spirit. You see yourself the way God sees you. You have the mind of Christ. You begin to think the way Christ thinks. Because our treasure and our affections are set on things above. The Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, dwelling in us, gives life, quickens your mortal body. It's not something that you have to work up to. It's something that automatically happens when you stay in him. When his Spirit dwells in you, and you're following hard after him, and you're obeying. And that doesn't mean if you miss it, that all that goes out the window. No, that means you've repented and God has restored you. He doesn't move out. He's there permanently. But we need to yield to him. His Spirit gives us life. It heals our physical bodies. That's why when a symptom tries to come on me, I don't care if it's a headache. It happened the other day, a headache out of nowhere. You know, most of the time you sit there and you say to yourself, oh, man, this headache. Let me go grab some Tylenol. And that's fine. But you know what I did? Immediately, I spoke to the headache. I said, no, I don't need to. I have the Spirit of life inside of me, which gives life to my mortal body. And I spoke to my headache, and it went away. It went away because it's impossible for me to stay sick. It's impossible for me to stay poor. It's impossible. Because I yield to the Spirit of God. I yield and I obey what the Spirit says. Do I hit the ball out of the park every time? No, I don't. If I did, I would have hung on the cross for everyone. But God knows I couldn't save myself, let alone the world. But when I do miss it, my heart is right before God. I quickly receive the gift of repentance and I endeavor to do what's right. And I yield. Consciously communicate with my senior partner on the inside, minute to minute, asking him for his advice. Where do I go? What do I do? How do I say this? What should we do? Glory to God. The Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. And he who raised Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. Let's just finish reading this. Verse 12. Maybe we'll get to 1 Peter tomorrow. Maybe I'll just open it up so at least I feel okay because I read it. But anyway. Glory to God. How many are glad you're hearing the word this morning? I'm glad you've tuned in. This is life. This is health. This is truth to us. Verse 12 of Romans chapter 8. So he says all this. If the Spirit, you know, the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, then that same Spirit will quicken and give life to your mortal bodies. So then, he says, brothers, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. We're not bound by that anymore. We've been bought from that, redeemed. We're not in debt to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. You will die. If you live according to the flesh, you will die. Disobedience brings death. Even simple things. Obeying simple. I was reading one of Brother Hagin's faith food, I think, devotional. You know, and so many people will blame God, or I guess the Lord just saw fit to take so-and-so home. No, if so-and-so would obey natural laws, maybe they'd still be here. If we walked in the Spirit, maybe they'd still be here. His story, he was talking about his own uncle. He worked in this factory with electrical equipment and whatever. And there was a big sign, big, that said, "Do not turn this breaker on unless you're standing on the rubber mat." So his uncle went outside, took a break. It was wet because it was raining, came back in, didn't put the mat down, and flipped the switch. And electricity went through his body. Now, he knew the Lord. He was a believer. So thank God he went to be with Jesus. But so many God-fearing, goodwill-meaning people said, well, the Lord saw fit to take him home. No, he didn't. No, he didn't. No, he didn't. There's natural laws. There's natural laws. If you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, what is he talking about? The selfish ambitions, the pursuit of happiness. I just need to put all my energies in being happy in this world. No, that's living according to the flesh. But if by the Spirit you put to death your carnal nature, the deeds of the body, you will live. You will live. And you will live. He who has a son has life. He's come that we might have life and have it more abundantly. You want the pursuit of happiness? You want those things in your life? Seek those things which are above first. Seek first his kingdom. Verse 14, for all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. If we're led by his Spirit, we're his children. For we did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then we're heirs. We're relatives. We're related. We're in the same family. Heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. Hallelujah. For I consider, verse 18, for I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing, not even worth comparing, not even worth saying in the same sentence, with the glory that is to be revealed to us. To us. Friends, our best days are in front of us. I don't care how good you may have thought you had it. Just like the Israelites. Oh, they forgot. They forgot how miserable it was when they were in Egypt. They forgot. But because they began to wander in disobedience and gripe and complain and yield to strife, they were forfeiting the blessings of God. They forgot the miracles that the Lord provided for them. And they began to complain. Why did you lead us out here into the desert, Moses, to kill us? We were better off back in Egypt. At least we had three square meals a day. They forget. Friend, our best days are ahead of us. They're ahead of us. Divine health and healing is yours for the taking. Prosperity is yours for the taking. Are you willing to do the process? Are you willing to go through due process? Are you willing to walk the walk? Are we willing to get willing? Are we willing to obey and follow hard after God? to put our flesh under, to not yield to the flesh when you get around people that are just ignorant and miserable and treat you wrong and talk bad and do all this and mistreat you and come against you unreasonably. The flesh is going to be tempted to lash out at them, but you know you're making progress when you bite your lip and you bite your tongue and you say nothing. You say nothing. And you just begin to pray in the Holy Ghost and ask for strength and to be delivered from the temptation to smack them, because that would not be right. That's crucifying the flesh. And the more we crucify, listen, in the beginning, it's a tough go. It's tough. It's like weight training. When you first start lifting weights, everything's good. But a day or two into it, your muscles start hurting real bad. And you don't want to do it anymore. But if you press through and you keep pushing on and you keep going and you're committed to it, the pain subsides and your muscles start to grow. And that's how it is spiritually, friend. When we crucify the flesh, the reason we're saying these things is because the law. The law of the Spirit of life, which is Jesus, Zoe life, eternal life, has set us free. So it's impossible for me to be sick and to be poor unless I choose to go back under judgment, which I would never do. I've been there before, and it isn't so great. It's miserable. Deuteronomy 28:22 said that we were cursed by the law. We were under the curse of the law. But Galatians 3:13 says that Jesus redeemed us from the curse, having been made a curse for us. He was made a curse for us. He became sickness. He became COVID-19. He became diabetes. He became cancer. He became back pains and shoulder pains and knee problems and blindness and deafness. He became all of those things so that we can be redeemed and never have them, never have them. So that doesn't mean that our adversary won't try to get you to yield to those things. But again, he can't just put them on you. Do you understand that? You are in control of that. He can't just put them on you. He could come to you and lay it on thick and try to get you to embrace it. He'll do that. He'll do that. He'll come with symptoms. But you just need to resist. You need to resist. And you need to say, no, it's impossible for me to be this because Jesus redeemed me. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ has set me free from the law of sin and death. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in me, and that Spirit gives life to my mortal bodies. It is virtually impossible unless I allow it in for me to be sick. So devil, beat it. And guess what? When you talk like that in faith, he runs. He runs. He runs. But he wants to try to berate us, try to wear us down, try to beat us down, try to get us to yield to temptation, try to get us to yield to feelings. No, we're soldiers. We don't yield to those things. We walk by faith, not by sight. We fight the good fight of faith. We don't lay down and allow ourselves to feel depressed and feel taken advantage of, and this just isn't fair, and God, I've been so obedient and so good, and why? No, that is the talk of a loser. And you know who talks that way? The devil. But we're not his. We're on the winning team. We're conquerors. If God is for us, friend, what could be against you? Doesn't mean that things won't try to come against you, but if they had any half a sense, they wouldn't. Because I'm a threat to the kingdom of darkness, and I like it that way. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So we've been redeemed from the curse of the law, and I think we're going to get to 1 Peter tomorrow because time has slipped away from us today, and I keep tempting you with 1 Peter. But listen, we heard the word this morning, amen, and the word of God is life. Friend, I believe that healing power is at work in your body right now. I believe that God and his ministering angels are bringing increase. If you've been obedient, if you've sown seed, hold fast. Don't grow weary. Faith to reap. Command him. Thank God that it's working, that the angels are bringing it to you. Increase is coming into your life. Your bills are being paid. Your needs are being met. Your debts are being reduced and eliminated. Your body is recovering. You're getting stronger, not weaker. You're getting healthier, not sicker. You're getting smarter, not dumber. Amen. Amen. This is how faith speaks. Glory to God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word today. God, your word is so good. It's like a shot of adrenaline. It's like it brings life. It brings joy. It brings health. It brings peace to us. And we're so grateful for it. We've taken your word today. It is working in our life right now. It is accomplishing what it says it will do. For we receive it by faith. We call our bodies healed. We call our bodies well, healthy, and whole. We call our needs met. We thank you that increase is coming into us because we're believers, and that's your will for our lives. And simply so that we can establish your covenant and do it in an over-the-top kind of fashion, because that's what you deserve, and we want to represent you right. So we thank you now. We lift our hands and give glory and honor to you, for you are worthy to be praised. Thank you for your word today. It's working in our lives, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you guys for tuning in today. If you'd love to partner with us, we'd love to have you. We're here for you. We want to pray with you, rejoice with you. You can reach us on our webpage, www.abundantgracechurch.com. You can partner with us financially. You can text your giving to 732-856-5050. You can also, on our webpage, there's a giving tab. Listen, if you need something, reach out to us. Call the church office, 732-914-2058. You can also email us. We check that all the time. AGC@abundantgracechurch.com. If you need prayer, we'll pray with you. If you want to rejoice and share praise report, we want to rejoice with you. Friend, we're in this together, and our best days are still ahead. So tune in tomorrow, 10:30, and then we have Sunday morning at 10 o'clock. We're going to be streaming live, and soon we'll be in person. God bless.